Committee Hebrew Ethics, Priest Rabbi L.M. Dumizu, a spirit, life spirit of Amen. Time to rebuild. Join us today, subscribe, and let us walk together this journey. We want to talk about the Ethiopian origin of the Tamils or Dravidian Indians. It is very clear that some Ethiopians, Indians, and Tamils have remarkable physical resemblances. You can look and you can find here the images of Ethiopian as well as Tamil and Indian women. You will never be able to distinguish who is who. But what we have to say is that the first people who arrived in India were Negroids. They came from Africa, they had black skin, and they have curly hair. We want to continue with this theme because we come to the point where anthropologists racked their brains as they battled to simply identify the Dravidians. The Dravidians here represent the whole group of ancient original indigenous Indians. They then created a new racial group which they named the Mediterranean race. I am reading from one of the authors here who said, overlooking momentarily these cultural acquired exaggerations of nature, we discover first that the Middle Easterners, there was no Middle East, we know that. The people in Middle East were brought in from other parts. They are not indigenous. The majority of the people, so-called Middle Easterners, white Arabs, they are not indigenous. We know that they came from via Turkey. Then he says, we discover first that the Middle Easterners do vary in race. Then he says, our area from Morocco to Afghanistan is the homeland and cradle of the Mediterranean race. Mediterraneans are found also in Spain, Portugal, most of Italy, Greece, and the Mediterranean islands. You see there, he never mentioned any African country. Why would he do that? Why use such terms? Very imprecise terms indeed. Such imprecise labels are fashioned by scholars and biased scholars to obscure the obvious racial types or to hide a truth. I'm reminded of Shannon, who termed who gave the word blind. Hence, they completely hide the real origins of many nations. Without an informed knowledge of anthropology, we thus stand academically confused or worse off, ill-educated, divided, and caused to hate and fail to even morally support our struggling brothers across the earth. That is the reason why they coin such terms. Thus, little knowledge or erroneous knowledge is dangerous in the sense that this type of knowledge becomes a type of mental blindness and uses a powerful applied psychological suggestion that forms a scholastic paradigm in our brains, and this becomes a base of habitual reasoning in the long-term memory via the suggestion of an interpretation of the concept of race in terms of geographical demarcation and geographical names. This is the reason why we should be very astute when it comes to the original Mediterranean race. Why? A race, when stripped of too many academic decorations and niceties, is identifiable by one essential factor, which is the skin color. That is what we see, and other features on the face or in the face. Due to this sagacity, we easily distinguish the black race, white race, or yellow race. These three races are easy to distinguish, and in between there is a lot of blending. So, what race are the Dravidians? Subsequently, it is obvious that the so-called Mediterranean race in origin is a Negroid or Africoid race. Why do we say that? Black skin, that's why we say that. And additional characteristics which are precisely those of the black people in general. An elongated skull or dolichocephalic jaw or protruding jaw, dark or brown or black skin. You can read Alexander Morris' description of the ancient Mediterraneans. To supplement this definition, The ancient Greeks did not label as white the inhabitants of Northwest Africa in their times. That is to say, the present Maghreb, Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, since they were called, and since they called them Maoroi or Moors, meaning people of dark skin. Herodotus, so-called Herodotus, writes about the Colchians, Northeast African people, as black as the Egyptians. So, who or where did the Davidians come from? Ethiopians in antiquity ruled India. These Ethiopians were named the Naga. There is a lot of debate around this word Naga. There was an astronomer called Asagan. If you reverse his name, he copies it from there. They also created a Sanskrit writing and language. We shouldn't prove to you that Sanskrit is an Ethiopian uses an Ethiopian-based alphabet. Ancient Dravidian literature, which dates back to 700 BC, shares a lot about the Naga. The Naga ruled all of India, Sri Lanka, and Burma. They were a warlike people who used the bow, arrow, and lance. You can see there the image there of their migration from Africa. And you can see there the top laughing young lady there is a Naga, is a Dravidian, is an African. There are no two ways about that. The Dravidian Tamils, you can see their images there. This comes from Dentas or Colombo. The Tamil people, or Tamil Tamiz, or Tamil Tamizakao, which is plural, also known as Tamila, Tamilians, or simply Tamils, are a Dravidian ethnic group who speak Tamil as their mother tongue. They trace their ancestry to the Indian state of Tamil Nadu, the Indian Union territory of Puducherry, or the northern eastern province and Puttalam district of Sri Lanka. Tamil people have a population of approximately 76 million living people around the earth. Thus, they are one of the largest existing ethno-linguistic cultural groups of the people in this modern world. We can't ignore this. They are our brothers. The Tamils comprise over 24.8% of the population in Sri Lanka. The other Sinhalese also derive from some of the people genetically connected to these Dravidians in 10.8% in Mauritius, 5.9% in India, 5% in Singapore, and approximately 7% in Malaysia. Some tips on their language. Now, according to Dr. Clyde Winters, Naga or Nagash was also the title of king of the ancient Semitic speaking people of modern Ethiopia who lived in Arwe and ancient kingdom in Punt. In addition, the ability of the Ethiopians as sailors is supported by the title Baha Nahash, ruler of the maritime province or Eritrea. You can see there is the image of Naga. There is the image of the Naga. This will become very critical shortly. In many Ethiopian traditions, the first empire was founded by Zas Bes Angabu of the Arwe line, who ruled Ethiopia for 350 years. This dynasty began in 1370 before Common Era. The traditions of this dynasty are in the Kebra Negus, or Glory of the Kings. You can read Doris in 1971. One more proof about where the Nagas came from. The earliest mention of the Naga appear in the Ramayana. They are also mentioned in the Mahabharata. In the Mahabharata, we discover that the Naga had the capital city in the Deccan and other cities spread between the Jumna and Ganges as early as 1300 before Common Era. The Dravidian classic, the Chiklipta Tikaran, made it clear that the first great kingdom of India was Naganadu. Now, the real origin, the real and the original Buddha, was he black or white or not? Buddhism actually started in ancient Africa and spread to the Indian continent, where the first inhabitants were black people who had migrated from Ethiopia some 50,000 years earlier, establishing what is known as the Indus Valley Civilization. The original statues of Buddha clearly show him as a pure Africoid. The wide nose, thick lips and frizzy nappy hair. These are distinctive African. In most Asian temples throughout Asia, he is shown as jet black. Many Asian temples in Asia and India still have statues of the gods and goddesses who carry these African features. Woolly hair or the peppercorn hairstyle, while some even have dreadlocks. Therefore, like their ancestors, the Buddha is portrayed in no uncertain terms with kinky hair, coiled hair, flat nose, and full bull lips. Here are the images of the original Buddha. You can see the Buddha on your screen. These are their images, and you can see also in Cambodia and many other places. African origins of all Asian philosophies is proved here by this image that we are showing. Because if you neglect researching your history, or if you research your history wrongly, without evidence, without knowing what to believe, what to trust, you cannot complain when other races steal that race and use it. We've got two images here of the Sesh meditation pose. You can see here the African one, the ancient Egyptian Sebek M. Inu in Kushite or Kemet. Sesh means scribe or thinker. Meditation pose, the earliest example of which dates to almost 3,000 years in Kemet. Buddha on the left side, there's the Kushite one, the copy one in meditation pose, first appeared 200 BC in India. It came from Africa, which is why Buddha is often shown with peppercorn African hair. The linguistic similarities, the Naga in India had a writing system which they introduced called Nagari. A Nagari is the name of the Sanskrit script. Over 100 years ago, Sir William Jones pointed out that the ancient Ethiopic and Sanskrit writing are one and the same. You can see there the Amharic on your left, and you can see there the traditional Sanskrit on your right. What's the difference there? You can see the A, E, I, O, U, Eri, Re, Iri. You can see Tata, Tada. You can see all other similarities there. You don't have to go far. More about the Nagas. The Naga migrated from Kush or Punt, Ethiopia, known in ancient times as Puntites. They were the greatest sailors of the ancient world. We have seen scholars already attesting to that. And by the fact that they are Africans in this land, attest and prove that. In Kimichu inscription, there are place names like Puntite Port of Otukulde, Hameso, and Takaru, which corresponds to Adulis, Hamesen, and Tigwe. Some Sumerian texts prove that Puntites traded with the people of the Indus Valley or Dilmun. Researcher S.N. Kramer in the Sumerian, his book, says part of Punt was probably called Methula, and Dilmun was probably the ancient name of the Indus Valley. Now, scholastic bias has always distorted our understanding and our knowledge. Writer William Jones has proved beyond reasonable doubt that the Ethiopian origin of Sanskrit is provable. This was supported by the fact that both writings start from the left to right. Also, vowels are annexed to the consonants. Some Eurocentric scholars try to reverse everything. The first thing they do is to posit a fact, a false fact, a blind, that Indians taught writing to the Ethiopians. As they do so, they know clearly that the name Nagari for Sanskrit is clearly an Ethiopic word in origin. Over and above this, it is open fact that Sanskrit vowels are A, E, U, E, O for Virama, etc., are in the same order as this language. The Ethiopian script has influenced not only this language but many other writing systems. Y.M. Kobishno in the UNESCO History of Africa maintains that Ethiopic was used as the model for Armenian writing, as was many of the Transcaucasian scripts. In Dravidian literature, it is obvious that the Naga introduced the worship of Kali, the serpent, Murugani, and the sun worship, as well as Krishna reverence. It is interesting to note that a god called Murugani is still worshipped by some tribes in East Africa. He is the other name is Murungu. That's where it comes from, Mulungu. So Krishna and Muruga. Etymologically speaking, the Sanskrit word Krishna means black or dark. At times, it is also translated as attractive or beautiful. Krishna, who was associated with the sun, means black. This is analogous to the meaning of Kuns of the Kushites. Homera, who is Homer, describes Hercules as follows. Black his tool as night, his bow and case, his arrow, his arrow string for flight. This mention of arrows identifies the Kushites, who were in ancient times known as the greatest bowmen, greatest users of the arrows and the bow. Now, you can see there is at the top is Krishna, at the bottom is the Naga. The very name Murugani itself, which signifies the young man in Tamil, he is the object of Krishna's assimilation by the Udaya Akapu. That's what it means. It is interesting to note that they write that while citing the Africanist George Parinda that at least 25 tribes in East Africa still worship Mulungu as a supreme deity. And like the Dravidian, therefore, in conclusion, ancient Africa is the source of indigenous peoples of India, the Dravidians and the Tamils. They spread into Ceylon, so-called Sri Lanka today. Ancient Ethiopian priests who still speak a language called Giz have been around on earth and speaking this language for over 4,000 years. Africa, via Ethiopia, once ruled all of India and all the islands that we have discussed before. So, before the advent of the Indo-European, Indo-Euro-Aryans, Africans dominated all these areas. The Ethiopians brought language, religion, customs, and culture into these lands with them. The Brahmins, or the priests of the white Aryans, were taught and they learned their ancient language of Sanskrit at the feet of black Ethiopians. Buddhism, Dravidians, all the people in Cambodia, in Sumatra, in India, in Mauritius, we are one people. We are one people. We are the survivors of the descendants of the original Tamils who came from Africa. Thank you. Goodbye.